And welcome to the Site Plan Review Tech Technical Advisory Committee meeting work session for July 14th. Per New Hampshire RSA 91-A:2-3B, the chair has declared COVID-19 outbreak an emergency and has waived the requirement that a quorum be physically present at the meeting pursuant to the governor's executive order 2020-04. Section 8 is extended by executive order 2020-10. An emergency order number 12, section 3. Members will be participating remotely and will identify their location and any persons present with them at that location. We don't have any votes, so we won't be doing any roll call. So starting with myself, I'm Juliet Walker, planning director, and I am in my office by myself. Dave.
Hi, Dave DeFosis, Public Works, in my office by myself.
At Howe Fire Department, in my office at Central Fire Station, also by myself.
Peter.
Peter Britz, in my home office by myself.
Mark.
Mark, Police Department, at the PD, in my office by myself.
Eric.
Eric Eby, at the DPW, in my office by myself.
Although there is some virtual person behind you doing something. Nick.
Nick Cracknell, I'm in the planning department and I'm by myself.
Okay. All right, the first item on the agenda is 64 Bond Street, Benditson, Portsmouth Realty Trust owner. Who's here to talk about that application?
Julia, if you don't mind making me co-host, I can help with the
technical. Oh, sorry about that. Yes, thanks. Julian's here as well. She's doing all the hard work behind the scenes.
All right, you guys got me?
Do.
All right, I'm Eric Sari from Aldis Engineering. I'm in my office and my dog's here somewhere. I do not know if Steve Wilson and Shane Forsley are on. If they are, we can let them into the meeting as well.
It does not look like they are on.
Oh, okay.
I didn't see them register for the meeting.
Shane Forsley was on there as an attendee for a minute, but he's gone now.
Oh, yeah, now he's on. Sorry.
He's here. Yep.
Now he's on. All right, let me know when you guys are ready.
You can go ahead.
Okay. Jillian, do you want to go to sheet G, C2, please? All right, that'll do it. Since our last discussion, we have worked to address the situation in the Worth lot. Starting in the middle with the green stripe on the plan, which is the sidewalk alongside of the Cabot House building. We started by widening that to 7 feet. To get that width, we've modified some of the parking inside the Worth lot itself. We've still got the one-way flow like it is now. We've got the angle spaces as before, but the biggest change is now front-end parking on the right-hand side right up against Vaughn Mall. That involves moving the median back to the left of the sheet towards the west by a few feet to open up that space. It does relocate the handicap spaces so that the striped aisles line up with the existing walkways. And it opens up two green spaces, two islands inside the parking lot on either corner at the top and the bottom.
Hold on, Eric. Can everybody just mute themselves? I don't know if that's feedback that we're getting from somebody's machine or not. Go ahead, Eric.
Okay. To accomplish this, the angled spaces are 17 feet deep, which is 2 feet shorter than allowed by the ordinance itself. So we would need a variance for that. I did check it with the fire truck. I ran the truck through there and I did submit that as an exhibit to the submission. It does work with the full size ladder. We also have 80 spaces now which is what's there now, at least on this plan. So we don't lose any spaces as we go through the project. Other changes are if you go towards the backside of the site on Hanover Street. Right now, there's a chunk of concrete sidewalk and what is essentially a landscape strip, maybe 3 feet wide. It's just dirt. There's nothing growing there. We've expanded the sidewalk to take that over all the way to the property line now. Now it's all new brick sidewalk. We've also narrowed up the driveway a little bit to 18 feet, which matches the ramp width. And that's essentially it for that. Oh, one other thing, we did straighten out the crosswalk going across the alleyway towards the Provident Bank piece. Now it's straight. One of the comments was before it was at an angle, so that has moved as well. We expanded the landing there. There's a transformer right there, so we expanded that to be sidewalk as opposed to mulch. Next sheet, C3, is grading. Not a lot changed here, except for in the upper corner of the Worth lot up against Vaughn Mall. Now we have a landscape down that is raised and curved. So I've added a new catch basin in the corner. And that existing basin, I just changed that to a drain manhole to receive the new pipe from the new catch basin. Everything else is essentially the same. I did relocate the roof drains. Instead of going out to Vaughn Mall, now I'm going down the alley to tie into a catch basin on the corner of the alleyway and Hanover. Next sheet on C4 is utilities. Like the drainage, we also shifted those away from Vaughn Mall. Now they're going out the back. Everything's going to Hanover Street. And that's it, essentially. Those are the changes from before. I'm sure you guys have some questions.
Okay, so let's go to the parking lot proposed changes. So first of all, this is a public parking lot. So the changes you're proposing would need to be approved by the city.
Absolutely.
They're not a variance because this is public property.
Well,
it's basically up to us to decide if we agree that these changes should be made.
Okay, I was looking at the parking space size, Jillian.
That's
okay, so we don't need
zoning requirement for private land.
Okay.
We certainly use it as guidance, and we might very well not be willing to vary from that standard, but it wouldn't require a variance.
Okay.
So the difference in I didn't see on the existing conditions plan how wide that aisle width is now.
Which one? The one towards the new sidewalk?
The one that you're proposing to modify.
Okay. You know what? I'm going to pull up the drawing on my plan. It's about 24 feet, but it varies a little bit. And it might be 26 in some places. I'm going to pull up the drawing and get you an exact measurement. Let's see here. Bear with me for 1 second. Yeah. All right, on the side towards the alley, you're looking at about 25. On the side closest to Vaughn Mall, it opens up to about 28. And then the one on the end, which runs parallel to Vaughn Mall, that is about 28 and a half from the end of the island to, there's two parallel spaces there now.
Okay, and then the green brick strip, you're proposing that the city give you that, or you're proposing?
I'm not sure what it should be called or what the language is, but it's similar to what was done with Provident Bank piece. Because we're going to have retail spaces and doors opening up on that sidewalk. We also need to have a license to construct it or an easement to construct it. So whatever the lawyers want to call it, I'm cool with that. I'm just calling it out as we're going to need some sort of legal instrument to make that allowable.
Okay. I'm opening up to other comments. I don't know that this TAC can make suggestions on the parking lot, but it's really going to need to be, you know, probably a public works director call on, and maybe city manager was my thought on whether or not we would agree to the changes to the public parking lot. But I think TAC's the appropriate first start here. Pat.
Yes, just a couple things on the width in that area. A normal fire lane minimum is 20 feet. This building, due to its height, would require 26 feet for the aerial. So, you know, shorten the width in combination with now having a shorter parking space and making it more likely that vehicles are going to be sticking out is going to be a problem for us. It takes a full 18 and a half feet for us to deploy the outriggers for the tower so we can deploy the ladder out of the bed. So that is a, that's a, that would be a concern for us.
Okay, thanks, Pat. Other comments? Peter?
Yeah, I just noticed that the sidewalk is 7 feet, the brick, the green brick sidewalk. And it doesn't look like the Provident Bank is that wide. If you reduce the sidewalk width, you might get bigger spaces, but I don't know if you can.
Well, we started at 5 last time through, and the comment was it's not wide enough. So we went ahead and moved it to 7. I could put you at 6 and make the spaces all about 17 and a half, or add that to the aisle width.
I'll defer to Dave and Eric and Juliet on that, but just something I noticed.
Yeah, Peter, I think that is that is one of the things I think they discussed last time, but given that it's being proposed as a sidewalk that's supposedly going to be accessed for this front of the store, it really needs to be wide enough to accommodate plenty of pedestrian activity if they're going to build it in that location. And I think it's the problem is, in order to build it, they need to use public right of way. So it's really a kind of a conundrum about how to resolve it. That's why we ultimately didn't think it would work.
Can I intercede at this point? This is Steve Wilson.
Well, I'd actually like, I think Dave, were you going to comment?
Oh, I'm sorry.
And then you can respond, Dave, Steve.
Okay, ahead, Dave. Thank you.
Peter is adamant that it'll be at least 5 feet clear. So it's usable once there's car bumpers overhanging it. And even with that, 5 feet is going to be, it's going to be very narrow if you're trying to entice walkers down that sidewalk. Do you want to comment I have about that? I have more, but only about that.
Okay.
I agree, because the parking spaces are short, people are going to overhang it more than they normally would if it was a normal split-side space.
All right, Steve, you wanted to say something?
Yeah, I just wanted to bring together the few variables regarding the sidewalk. We widened the sidewalk. There's the issue of the plow working on that sidewalk at the width that it's at. They need 5 feet as a minimum to run the plow down it. Also, I wanted to point out that so there may be a point between 5 feet and 7 feet that works. The existing parking spaces are 18 feet or even slightly less if you look at the existing conditions. And the so we've gone from 18 to 17. And on the long side of these diagonal spaces are actually that exceed the 19 feet. So to say it's going to overhang 2 feet would be, you know, that would be a pretty extreme overhang, but I don't think we'd have a problem with people parking sloppy. Right now there's no overhang and we don't have cars out into the driving area. And we're really just trying to put in balance. The first thing I'll say is how important this sidewalk is to the continuity of, we put the sidewalk on the side of the Provident Bank building in a similar fashion. And I think we all recognize that it was a minimum width, but it already had a curb there, et cetera, for the parking. And right now, people go off the end of that sidewalk from the corner of the Provident, and they walk out into the traffic lane. So in our presentation, we're trying to balance pedestrian rights or pedestrian ease versus vehicular ease. And I think I'd point out to Pat regarding the width of the travel lane. At its narrowest point, it's over 18 feet, but on the proposed plan, you could set up easily at the end of, in the travel lane towards Vaughan Mall in the instance of it, which will always be clear because it's travel lanes. And as soon as you get to the other corner of the building, the it broadens up by virtue of the end of the alleyway, and then once again stays at the same width. So there's no dramatic reduction or increase in either the parking lot, either the parking space lengths or the travel lane from before, pre and post development. So we are trying to put that in balance. We're trying to recognize the pedestrian issue that exists there. And I just have to say it's extraordinarily critical to the redevelopment, reconstruction of the building. And once again, having sidewalks all the way around that parking lot. And I think looking at this plan, one of the real positives is that it annexes another 500 or 600 square feet to the Vaughan Mall pedestrian area at the corners, which are now, you know, crowded with parking. And so we're trying to put that in balance. And that's all I wanted to say regarding parking spaces. We can certainly look at a 6-foot sidewalk with maybe a little taller curb that would make this the parking space is 18 feet as they are now, but being on the diagonal, the minimum length of that space is 18, and they, on the other end, it's 21 and a half or something like that. So there you go.
Okay, thanks. Other comments from the TAC members?
How about the turning movements for the WB 40 and 55s that are in there every morning? Do those work?
I can run that, Dave. I just ran the fire truck because that was a comment at a TAC work session the last time around. My guess is if the tower can make it, a WB 40 can do it too. But okay. I will run that.
Pat?
Yeah, I just go back and comment on the width of the travel lane. We would likely go the wrong way to set up the ladder. Up that side. So it's, you know, we wanted the turning template. That's great. It's wicked tight. It would take a perfect driver in perfect conditions not to hit a car, but we probably wouldn't go around anyway. We just go the wrong way. But that area on that corner by the alley, which is its narrowest spot, is really the most critical for us because that's where we're going to put the tower so we can hit two sides. That's the only place we can put our turntable on the tower and hit two sides of that building. And that's where it's going to be placed more than likely. We try and stay out of the full front face because that's a collapse zone. Obviously, we don't want a truck in a collapse zone. So when you're looking at trying to maximize, you know, our access, I would focus on that area, which is the area that is currently appears to be the shortest distance or the narrowest.
And I'll point out that if you look at the pre and post development with the perpendicular spaces in there, that actually that last space, you know, falls out into the alleyway, if you will. And when we turn them on the diagonal, it actually broadens that area. But we can certainly, now we have a point of emphasis there. So we know where we have to, would have to accommodate that ladder. So thank you.
Okay, so any other comments on the parking lot, which is public space, and the sidewalk, which is use of public space?
The only comment that I had regarding the public space would be that if we are going to end up adding handicap spaces, I'm not sure whether, Eric, did they come out of that over by the dumpster right now?
Right now, there's two over there. I'm actually not gaining or losing. It's the same number. There's three of them on that side, down towards the south. So they're on either side of the dumpster. Mm-hmm. So I just rotated them out.
So you're moving them away from the Worth building.
The two on the bottom are right next to where they are now. The one up top is definitely moved. About 100 feet. North of where it is now,
but the elevator for the Worth building is in the middle of the building.
Okay, there's also, if you look on the left hand side, there's also two more handicap spaces towards the end of the plan on the left.
Right.
Those I'm trying to distribute them evenly.
And there's a net loss of parking spaces in the parking lot as proposed, right?
No, we nail it. It's dead on. Existing matches proposed.
Okay, I saw 14 in the existing.
14. On this plan, it shows 80 proposed and there's 80 existing within the viewport of this sheet. There's obviously more off to the left off the plan. But what you can see, there's 80 existing and 80 proposed.
Okay, I'm just confused how that tallies up, because in the part that abuts the building, there's 14 spaces in the existing conditions.
They added quite a few spaces on the right side there, because those are parallel parking on the.
Got it. Okay.
Yeah, there's only two there now, and now there's 9 along that side.
We kept 2 on that side to make sure that the turning movements would work with the tractor trailers that are in there every day.
Right.
Yeah, I didn't really change the aisle width that much there, Dave. But as I said, I'll run the WB40 on it and see what it does.
So okay. The other thing is, if this layout holds, we will expect that the entrances of the Vaughan Mall get modified accordingly. The curbing will have to shift and move accordingly, so that everything relines up with your new parking layout, and the guardrail need to be extended and or truncated as necessary.
Okay.
Yeah, definitely.
It's only going to be a few feet, so that's an easy fix.
May I say this to the group? I think this is a work session, and I think that there's some detail work to be done with you people. For sure, how we annex this found space at the corners onto the, so you see how the raised beds are there now, there's raised landscape beds. You know, we're gonna need to work on a smaller detail to develop those areas to be most effective as tying it into the Vaughan Mall. Because it wants to be, I think, the whole, you know, they want to be held together. And right now there's curbing and fencing in the way. So certainly there's more detail to be done there.
Yep, and we're telling you what that detail is gonna be. So yeah, I think the layout of the parking lot is gonna have to be resolved directly with the Public Works Director and probably with sign off from the city manager before this can move forward to final site review process.
So sure.
The fact we're giving you today is guidance, and then I think there's going to have to be a follow-up conversation directly with the Public Works Director based on the feedback we're giving you today. All right. Any can we just have comments now on the non-public components of the proposed site plan?
Juliet.
Yes.
One other thing, if we do end up with this angle parking, it reinforces the one-way flow in here.
It does.
And we would like to see something probably happen out at Maplewood with the driveways. Because, you know, our long-term plan is possibly closing those driveways off, maybe in the short term, make them a right in, right out, get rid of the left turns, have the left turns come up that alley to Hanover so that they can be made at the signal at Hanover and Maplewood.
Okay, good point. Yeah, I think we need to definitely keep in mind what our future plan is for that, as well as the park, the idea of the longer-term strategic vision for Vaughan Mall.
Yeah, I will comment though on the left off the plan, right up against Maplewood, there is an aisle width there that does not go into the road. It's internal to the parking space or into the parking lot, so people can make that turn. And so basically, they can just orbit the parking lot for as long as they want until they find a space. Mm-hmm. And I think I'd rather have that be one way flow than two way. It's going to be a lot cleaner and safer.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so comments on the private components.
You mind if I start?
Go ahead, Dave.
Okay. Things identified were need to identify a grease trap location. Eric, where the water services are shown going into the building, you're going to be 5 feet below the slab.
Right now, yes.
Entering the building.
Yep.
So we're going to want to see how that's detailed.
Okay.
And verify that that's actually the best spot to bring in water services.
Okay.
Putting you on record that the sewer in this area is subject to backup. And
okay.
That you should have no open devices down in the basement. Everything needs to be closed and sealed.
Yeah, that's not going to be an issue at all. And as I think I stated at the prior session, we believe a chunk, at least more than half of this building's roof goes into the sewer now. So we're going to be taking that out. So that should help a little bit with your overflow.
Fourth common, you need to separate the building from stormwater from sewer.
Yep.
And that needs to be verified by Public Works people inside the building.
Okay.
Fourth comment, we're going to expect building owner to maintain this green sidewalk.
No problem.
It's not green.
And then last comment, I noticed that the roof design is changing when you look at the elevational view. We're interested to know how you're going to control ice from falling off the roof and onto cars and pedestrians.
Okay, thanks, Dave. Other comments?
Yeah, a couple. So we would want to know too where your elevator would be so we can figure out how this would work for our ambulance calls, which would be a much higher percentage of our calls going there anyways. So wherever the main entrance or lobby or elevator, we would just want to have an idea where that is.
We can illustrate that, unless you want to hear now, but we can illustrate that to you. On the Worth Ave side of the building, there would only be two entrances, one for a minor retail space in the back of the building towards the alley, as you see on the rendering. And also there'll be a guest entrance that goes into the elevator lobby for the residents upstairs. That elevator lobby would have an entrance from the rear area, the driveway area, which would be tough to get into with an ambulance, et cetera. So an ambulance would pull up in front of the Worth lot side of the building. But I'll get together with you on that, Pat, and illustrate that to the group when the time comes.
Okay, and then what is this concrete step that's shown, I think I'm on the same sheet you want to see too, by the ramp. Is that this 4x1x7 inch concrete step? Is there a door there or something?
There's a service door there. I believe the Mexican place takes their deliveries in there. And so to make the ramp work, we wanted to start the ramp and, you know, decrease the slope as much as possible. So I needed to maintain access to that door. So I just gave them a step. I did put a few bollards out there as well to protect it. So the door swings open, it's going to hit the bollard, and cars will steer around because the bollard and the step are there.
And that's also might be part of their egress too, so we'd want to keep an eye on that. That's definitely part of their egress.
It comes from the basement, Patrick, particular door. So take a look at that, what they use it for.
I know it's part of their egress. There's a stair from their main floor that goes down into that hallway in the basement, and that's their remote, their second exit out.
Good. I never looked in the door to see if it went up as well, so that's good information.
Yeah, there's a hall about maybe 15, 20 feet down the hall is where the stairs enter that from above.
Great.
Steve, I don't think we're going to want ambulances sitting out in the Worth lot.
I agree. That's
not what you intended, right? Because that would lock up the one-way parking lot.
My intention would be to make sure that the driveway entrance to the building has a clear access to that lobby from the driveway, our driveway, and also it's wide enough not to cause a problem for like the door that Patrick's talking about. So we can dial in the exact width of that driveway and have an area where an ambulance could sit and they could get a stretcher in and off that elevator very quickly. So I'm hopeful that we don't have a lot of ambulance activity, but one is enough. So, I mean, I think I have to deal with that architecturally, Dave.
Anything else, Pat?
No, that's all I have for now.
Okay. Anybody else have comments? Okay, I don't see any. So I think, Steve, that a good next step would be to coordinate with me and the Public Works Director. If you want to coordinate with me, I'll set up a meeting with the Public Works Director virtually, and whoever else from Public Works needs to be involved. And maybe Pat would be helpful to have you in that meeting or somebody from the fire department. Does that sound good, Dave?
Yeah, we're going to want the turning movements first, of course.
Okay, so be prepared to provide the turning movements for that meeting.
Okay. I'll send them to you, the WB40 to you, David. I'll copy Juliet.
That sounds good. And then once we receive those, we'll set up a meeting. And like I said, it sort of depends on process here in terms of whether this also needs approval by the city manager. So. Okay.
Thank you all for your time. I appreciate it. It's very important to us. So I appreciate all the attention you're paying to it.
Thanks, Steve. Thanks, Eric.
Thank you.
Thanks, guys. Have a good day.
Okay, you too. Okay, the next item is Patricia Drive. And Mike Garapi, I believe, is here to present on that.
All right. Hey, guys.
Hello.
I was wondering if I was in the right meeting link because I couldn't see my video share and audio share, but I guess you've got to give me that permission. So I was a little bit worried about that, but I'm here.
Well, Jillian can share her screen. If you really are dying to share your screen, we can, but she has.
No. Nope, that's totally fine. I was worried because I couldn't see my ability to share my audio and video. So,
got it.
Anyway, I now know what happened. So, anyway, I appreciate the time. And I think I'm not sure if Tom Doobie, the applicant, is on or in. I think he's on and listening. But and Kevin Baum has joined us as well. From Hope of Phoenix, Gormley and Romley. We've got a property here that I think I've spoken to several of you about. It's a property that is on off of Martha Terrace. It's a little over 3 acres in size. And it has frontage on an old road that appears to be a town right-of-way and a town road. Done some work out there, some due diligence, some survey work out there to determine that there is existing pavement out there in varying widths that we saw, anywhere between 24 and 20 feet. There's existing catch basins and drainage structures out there, and there's water stubbed to the road as well. And I know that the road, Patricia Drive, was proposed to at one point back in the 70s extend through this property and then loop back out to the existing Patricia Drive. So that obviously didn't happen. And then there was a lot line adjustment done in 2005 between several of the parties, the Fritz family and I believe the Price family. So the idea of the connectivity went away in 2005, essentially. So our plan essentially is to subdivide this property into two conforming lots rather, with conforming frontage and lot size, and meeting all the setbacks that are required for the house location and septics, etc. And then met with Dave DeFossis on site just to talk briefly about the existing condition and what we might need to do for improvements. And I certainly let Dave speak for himself, but what we're proposing is to basically strip the existing asphalt off of the road and repave a 20-foot wide road, which would be compliant with your neighborhood slow street standards and your road standard manual. And basically tie everything into the already existing catch basins and with some minor drainage improvements to accommodate the drainage from the road. And that's essentially it. The only other thing I might mention is that we were, in order to avoid as much buffer impact to the wetlands as possible, we're proposing to have a driveway easement for lot one over lot two. And we're sort of looking for some direction from you folks just to kind of make sure we're going in the right direction before we get to planning.
Good, thank you. So we did, as Mike knows and others, we have looked at this property a few times. It was up for sale, and so a number of people inquired on the status of that, what is a partially paved right-of-way that was never fully completed. I think what from the planning department's perspective, what happened was this was approved as a subdivision and laid out as a subdivision road, but was never actually fully constructed to city standards, and therefore also our view is I don't think it was ever accepted as a city street. So it's sort of a little bit of a quasi state in terms of actual ownership. It's not really a public right of way at this point, although it's laid out as a subdivision road, because the city never really, from our perspective, accepted it as a road. What you're proposing is to modify the original subdivision to reduce the width of the road and have it not necessarily conform with our subdivision standards, but some of the guidance that we do have out there, and finish the road. I think our understanding is that you're proposing, or that our preference would be that it would be a private road, that you would still have to get modified subdivision approval for it, but that I don't think the city is necessarily interested in having this little stub of a right-of-way in terms of our maintenance responsibilities. But that you need it as a right-of-way, because if it was just a driveway, you would have a hard time meeting street frontage requirements. So you're proposing the driveway to the second lot, you said, as an access or an easement across the first lot?
Correct. Yep. It's shown as such on the plan, and I think that seems to be the most logical location from a grade perspective.
Okay. All right, questions from TAC?
Yeah, I have a couple.
Yep.
So that's a private road and then a long private drive. Is the existing house that's out there going to remain, or is that?
There is no existing home on the property. It's a vacant parcel.
So you're adding just one home on the lot behind, is that correct?
Two homes.
Two homes.
The proposal is for two homes.
Okay. I'm just looking at Google Map Satellite. It shows the house there, but I don't know why. So anyways, because of their distance from, you know, a fire department access road that meets the requirements, they would likely need a sprinkler systems. They would only require 13D with a single family.
There is a hydrant in the street. I don't know if we've located that on the plan. We can locate that for you. What's the requirement for distance to?
We have to have a fire department access road that would meet the specifications of a fire department access road within 50 feet of at least one door.
And as proposed, I don't think this meets our subdivision requirements, right? So it therefore doesn't meet fire department requirements.
Right, it would require a 20-foot fire lane with a turnaround. But you don't have to have a fire lane with only two single family homes, but you would need to have the sprinkler system without it if we can't get within 50 feet of a door.
The idea that we had is to modify the end of this road, probably a little bit more refinement than is shown, but to create kind of a small hatchet, hammerhead, if you will, at the end, so that it provides a spot for the fire department to get their apparatus in and to the end of the road and then make their turn from there if need be. So we can work on that to make sure we've got the right turning radius for you. And then I think we'd be close enough, or you'd be able to get close enough to eliminate that sprinkler requirement.
That's one or the other. So, you know, it's up to you as a design professional, which one you want to do.
Sure. Yeah. We'll take a look at it for sure.
Yep.
Okay. Other comments? Peter?
Yeah, I've got a few. I guess one is sort of a question in terms of your setback for your wetland. I saw that you put the two leach fields in the 100-foot buffer, and I guess as a starting point on a new lot that hasn't been developed, I think you're going to have an easier time getting through the Conservation Commission and Planning Board conditional use permit process if you keep everything out of the buffer, including the leach field.
Yeah, we looked at that, Peter, and we may be able to do that, but the ordinance actually allows the septic systems to be within 75 feet of the wetlands. So that's why we located it as such.
What ordinance are you looking at?
Well, I don't have it right in front of me, but I can get it to you. It talks about, I think it's actually in the wetland ordinance itself, I believe, but let me find the reference and I'll email it to you. I mean, but I guess at the end of the day, we're happy to try to see if we can get it out, fully out of the 100-foot setback if we can. But we did try to show, the four different setback lines in different coloration on the plan so we could kind of see what each setback line required, what you can and can't do within them. So
I think you might have been looking at a pretty old ordinance, Mike.
Yeah, I don't remember that requirement being
waivable. I may have been, but I'm pretty sure I pulled it directly off the new ordinance. But if I'm mistaken, so be it. And I guess the other question would be, based on what you just said about conditional use permit, Peter, is there going to be a requirement for one if we're fully outside of the limited cut for
it? No, if you're outside of the wetland buffer, there won't be one, but I don't see how that's possible given your unless the road, the right-of-way is somehow an existing right-of-way, you're just improving. We'll have to talk about that.
But the road is, the pavement's already there. We're just proposing to get, and the catch basins are there. There's four catch basins out there, and the pavement's already there. We were just proposing to remove it and then repave, and it would ultimately make the drainage improved out there so that we could further protect the wetlands than they are now. I know in one area the water just drains off Martha Terrace and just dumps right into the buffer and then ultimately to the wetlands, so we were proposing to riprap that and kind of create a level spreader on the other side.
I think it would be hard to reconstruct the road, which is what removing the pavement and putting it back down again, without some kind of temporary impact on the, to me that qualifies as a temporary impact that would need a wetland conditional use permit.
I think the issue really is what are each setback line, what do they require? The 100-foot setback line, at least from my read of the ordinance, is that it's a building setback. And then you look at the other, you've got to sort of, Peter, no, I'm not as probably,
are you reading the parts of the wetland requirement?
I'm not as well versed in your wetland setbacks as you guys are, but my read of it suggests that that these different tiers are what's required. So
okay, so maybe I should just jump in here. Anytime you put a shovel in the ground within 100 feet of the wetland, you're going to need some kind of conditional use relief.
Okay.
But I would encourage you to take a look at the ordinance online so you have the most up-to-date one.
Sure.
There's quite a bit in there in terms of a wetland enhancement plan for how you're going to restore the buffer for where you have impacts in it. You certainly should design your project to stay 100 feet back on everything you can, especially the septic. That's going to get a lot of pushback. The other thing that keep in mind is, it looks like, I'm not sure, but it looks like your slope is greater than 10% on this. If that's the case, then your vegetated buffer will be at 40 feet instead of 25 feet, that where you have the 25-foot vegetated buffer strip, that'll go back to 40.
Okay.
Take a look at that section. I would just read through it. You'll see what I'm talking about in terms of.
Sure. Sure. Details, I can float some questions by you via email if we've got some questions, Peter.
But my best advice to you is to look at the site. It's a really nice wetland and conservation land that you're bordering there. It's the edge of Packer Bog, and there's some really nice wetlands out there. It hasn't been treated very well. I didn't notice that until recently when this kind of came alive when it went for sale, and some people have been cutting trees and clearing. So I would include some kind of restoration plan on that lower part of the buffer, which could be really nice. Just take a look at where they cut the trees and what you could replant in there. And then the other consideration, it isn't so much of the buffer, but a question, I guess, is, had you thought about doing a shared driveway instead of the two driveways leaving the cul-de-sac, just have one. It goes shared all the way to the back property with a short little stub of a driveway to the first house and then a longer driveway to the second house. That way you won't have two steep hillside driveways going in. Not that they're in the buffer, it's more of a
design. We certainly can look at that too. We kind of toyed with with both ideas. I know I'm pretty sure we can make these grades work, but and we maybe just putting some profiles to this, to the longer driveway would kind of demonstrate that. But we'll definitely look at that. One quick comment, Peter, about that vegetated buffer strip is that there's a fairly well established and what appears to be an older trail that we show on the plan that runs along near the edge. It's on the plan. You can see it. I don't know if we'd want to, were you thinking about replanting in that area?
If there's a trail, I would say, keep it. It's nice to have trails.
Yeah.
I'm just saying,
yeah.
I see a lot of stumps out there and I didn't get calls or I didn't know that some trees have been cleared. So putting up, just being sensitive to the buffer there and trying to restore
what
you can is always good.
Yeah. Yeah. Agreed.
Okay, any other questions or comments from TAC?
Is Dave still on the call? Because if you have any feedback for us beyond what you told us on site, that would be great to hear.
Regarding what?
Regarding any concerns you might have. I just, we want to make sure we go to the planning board with the best plan right out of the gate. I want to make sure we've got, you guys all on board. And
well, I think you'll see us again for another TAC round before.
Sure. Right. Yeah. Okay. And I think one thing I failed to mention too is that we did do a sieve analysis of the material under the pavement. And it's good material. I think Dave, you might have mentioned it probably came from the Iofola pit from years ago. So it's good base material for a road for sure.
If there is a road there, there'll be a private road. So
Yeah, we're totally fine with that being a privately maintained roadway.
Mike, if I can add one more thing about the roadway, obviously we need to have whatever widths Public Works and the Fire Department need, but to the extent that you can reduce that private drive going in, it's going to be completely in a wetland setback. So less is more in that case.
Yeah, we're absolutely happy to make it as narrow as we possibly can, to a reasonable extent, subject to the fire department's approval. Happy to make it narrower than 20. We're trying to follow your street guidelines as well. So. But I get it. Two lots probably don't need 20 feet. So
I don't know. Pat and Eric might.
I don't know. We'll see. Yeah.
Just a quick comment on the garage placement and the driveway connectors. I'm having a hard time seeing how someone's actually going to back out of the garage and not back down the entire driveway to get out. Doesn't look like those turnaround aprons are well positioned to make the garages work. So small point, but same with your lot two access off the end of the private way. It's a little bit awkward to go up there in the manner in which you drew.
Yeah. Well, these are schematic only right now. Maybe the final house plans and footprints, but likely to change, but. Is that something that you guys want to see on a final subdivision plan? Is the actual house location and a grading plan, or is that not is that required?
Well, I think no, it's not required in terms of the final house footprint, but we'd like to see the proposed house locations, particularly
sure.
in this case where you have very limited opportunity for development. If your grading plan is going to be substantial to create those house lots, then I think we're also going to want to know what that is.
Sure. Yeah, we can show a
conceptual, you know, plans that are more fine-tuned than this, with grading and everything. Basically, a septic, you know, a septic plan for each lot.
Okay.
For your wetland conditional use, any grading in the 100-foot buffer would have to be shown. So.
Okay. Fair enough. I promise I'm gonna read that ordinance with a fine-tooth comb, Peter. And I may have questions for you.
Feel free to give me a call. Yep.
Okay. All right. Yep. Awesome.
Okay. Any other comments from TAC?
Just because of what has happened in the past, I think calling this Patricia Drive is misleading. Vis-a-vis Pat thinking that it was the other end of Patricia Drive. So I think we should stop calling it that for reference. Just for
right.
Yeah.
There's two ends.
It's going to be a different name if it has a name.
Yep.
Yeah, we noted that, I think, on the plan that we were going to, you know, obviously change the name. Maybe we didn't put that, call that out, but we understand that there's already a Patricia Drive. So I think your tax maps may show it as Patricia Drive.
Not anymore.
Or at least the old survey plan I have does. But anyway, we definitely plan to give it a name, and you know, maybe we can find one of that's of historical significance or what have you. So we'll figure that out.
All right, sounds good.
Thanks for the feedback.
Sure. All right, take care, everybody.
Awesome. Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye bye.
That adjourns our TAC work session. Bye, everybody.
Bye.
Bye bye.